Evening Wobblers, I don't know why I said that. We're back. Just despite my best efforts, the audio's been a bit wonky on two now, so hopefully it's a little bit better now.
This bookstore is not okay. Strictly about crime, romance, and biographies of famous people. There's also a wide range of paranormal literature.
Slightly interrupted me there. A little bit rude, I'm going to be honest. But anyway, we'll look past it. Yeah, so hopefully levels are alright now. If they're not, I apologise. Deathly afraid of making my own voice too loud. But press on. Let's look through this shelf then, since it's so paranatural. Paranatural, is that a word? I guess it is here.
Amidst the various books, you find one written by someone named Matthias W. Dundas. It's about wholeness, unity, balance.
Oh dear, sounds culty.
The point of the book, and many others on this shelf, is to give people medicinal advice in situations where they don't have access to paid health services.
Homeopathy, you mean?
It serves platitudes, while also telling everyone that traditional medicine, the kind people don't have access to, and which costs more than this book, is garbage, and would only give you cancer anyway, without even curing your cold or anything.
Oh. Sound like very knowledgeable people, and not at all ducks. Quacks. Sorry, got that wrong.
Wholeness, unity, balance, on the other hand, can basically take care of anything. Though it is important to note, when it's up to your mind to heal yourself, then it's because of your mind that you're ill in the first place.
That seems like horseshit. That's giving me riddle vibes. It's not a riddle at all, but it's just too many similar words in the same space of time, so it confuses my poor brain. But is it up to my poor brain to fix that, or would, you know, better education have helped and maybe less drinking? I don't know. For this character, I mean, not me. Anyway, does the book say anything else?
The book features chapters on topics such as how to find magnesium. It even lists plants you can harvest magnesium from. How to continue drinking if you're an alcoholic who has destroyed his liver.
Oh, that's appropriate.
There's even a chapter on the ancient Serais tradition of using duck gallbladder.
Oh, that's appropriate as well.
To treat and prevent sexually transmitted diseases. Pre and post factum apply. Nothing worth buying.
The quacks will teach you how to use quacks to stop getting the clap.
This is just mundane garbage. What's even paranormal about this?
Fair point. I agree with you, globe-headed individual. Oh, cool. Well, it'd be surprising if this fails.
You sense something ominous emanating from the shelf, but it lacks form and substance. And soon enough, you lose track of it.
Okay, I genuinely did not expect that. I should have by now. This game has thrown a few curveballs like that. I just thought 92% is solid. We're not gonna.
Sir, please, no browsing in that shelf. That wisdom is not for free. I can't have you end up like opening a police store next door and stealing my customers. Oh no.
Fuck are you talking about? Whatever.
This bookstore is
Same thing. Kim's busy looking at a plant, I guess.
Several maps have been attached to a bulletin board hidden inside the alcove. They're held up by small pins. The board has come loose from one corner. The maps look old and faded. Your eye catches a map of Insulinda, a map of Revachol, and a map of Martinez.
I always wondered how that was pronounced. Insulinda, that sounds more poetic and lyrical than Insulind, which is kind of how I thought.
This large map displays archipelagos, You see a constellation of small dots on the light blue emptiness of the Insulindic Ocean. The largest in the northeast is Lacayu. You are here. Another, far away in the southwest, Seminese Islands, Ile de Fantôme. Ozon, Laurentide, Fas Alamir, Archipelagos, North Arcade Islands, all just specks of dust on the vastness of the Insulindic. On the edges of the map, the color fades into a blur of dotted lines, black and white. In the northeast, a dust mite stands on the north coast of Caillou, in a bookstore. It's you. Radiating outwards from you, the suzerain Revachon. With a radius of 80 kilometers, still, the crown jewel of this Isola would be barely visible.
Squinting seemed to work well for us the last time.
You can, on Caillou, Revachon, a single black star, on Ozon, Fondelier, and Vimandu, on Archipelagos, Croyan Moran, Villiers, on Seminine, Olduvai, and on Laurentide, Deora of the Seven Seas.
That's a lot of names that mean very little to me.
The ocean breaks apart into a tangle of cosines and azimuths, all pointing into pale nothingness. Windy is the north azimuth. Grad is the northeast azimuth. Samara is the east azimuth. Seol is the west azimuth. Isolas, they're called.
That would probably mean more if I knew what an azimuth was.
Connections to other worlds, words past the Insulindian, unknown to you. You only know you've never been there.
Worlds unknown to me? Words unknown to me, to be honest. Problem with this game is you don't know which ones they've just made up and which ones are actually just beyond my vocabulary. But, the only thing I have noticed is...
You have little idea
what they
are.
Come back to...
Distant stars, gods, but looking at them makes you feel almost non-existent. Whatever they are, the Isolas are immeasurably large compared to you, and very, very far away.
Okay, so the character's encyclopedic knowledge and my own is about on par.
Perhaps they are gods. Gods of distance and outer dust.
One thing I've noticed with a lot of the language here, it's clearly a kind of, you know, fictional, its own type of language it's trying to do, but it does feel very French influenced as well. You probably notice that yourself with things like Martinez and Revachol, particularly with this now voice acting that's in the final cut, you can tell in the pronunciations of a lot of things. Not that I'm hugely knowledgeable on French, but I went to Disneyland once. That was fun. And they mostly spoke French. Mostly.
The north coast of a verdant island is shattered by the delta of a river. It is the River Esperance. Countless bridges put the shards back together, connecting city blocks to river islands. La Delta says a great artificial heart in the center, teeming with life forms and construction. To the east, rolling hillsides, Le Jardin, Stella Marie, the suburbs of Saint-Baptiste, swallowed up into the megacity. They sound rich to you. This is Revachol East.
Maybe they're not French then, if they just sound rich. Or maybe French sounds rich. Who knows?
Houdon. It's somewhere to live. Not bad. Then there's Jamrock. It's bad. People shouldn't live there. But they do. Then Forberg. It's almost as bad, and much larger. Then Coal City. It's the worst. It's so small you can't even see it on the map. No, wait. There it is. North of Jamrock, the strip of coast next to the Greater Revachol Industrial Harbor. It looks downright despondent. It's almost Coal City, to be honest. No, Coal City is worse. A charred limb. Rain falls on its slick black streets. And then there's the burnt out quarter in the heart of Jamrock. Is it cold in this bookstore? Or is it just you?
I think it's just you, actually, considering you're called Shivers. That would probably be your primary function. But I believe that's meant to expand to, you know. Hunches, not wistful, random feelings and stuff.
It's not really a map. It's a tourist thing. A picture postcard with buildings on it, drawn from an isometric perspective. A date in the upper right corner says 48. Still, it's detailed. Could be pretty useful for scouting ahead. You see the jagged boxes of an industrial harbor, even the whirling in rags there.
I'm sorry, officer. The map of Martinez is the only one available. The other two are not for sale anymore. And besides, you could scarcely afford them. They're quite
seems
valuable,
incongruous.
Though they might not look it. The map of Martinez is 90 cents, though.
But it's also not for sale.
That old thing. It's an out-of-date map of a tourist location that never was nor came to be. From when some design studio people tried to spruce the place up 4 or 5 years ago, they also renovated the horse statue, set up those coin-operated viewers, and designed the new street lamps. They didn't get that far, for some reason. A shame the project never got going. Would be nice if someone fixed Martinez up. All these ruins are bad for business.
Right, well, we can't buy the map of Martinez because we, despite it being only 90 cents, we have a mere 60 to our name. We could try and steal it. I mean, if we fail, who are we going to piss off? This woman? I don't much care about that. We might piss off Kim, but which I do care about, but that's inevitable.
Slowly, you move your hand toward the map attached to the board. Before you even reach the map, you're interrupted.
Perhaps not. It's against RCM policy to defraud small business owners.
Ah, fuck. Fine, Kim. You are my conscience, I suppose. Or maybe I'll just
on the
try again when you're not here.
Biographies of famous people. You see a large variety of names, none of which ring a bell.
I don't want to talk to her.
Browsing through all the books with all their names makes your head spin. None of these seem important or relevant. It's all just vapid egoism.
Well, yeah, it's biographies of famous people.
Suddenly, a particularly odd title catches your eye. It reads, High Speed Love, the tragic true love story of Jacob Irv and Alfie Delatraz by one Cecilia Averbrook.
Irv? I wouldn't have pronounced it like that, but then I wouldn't know how the fuck you would pronounce it. IRW? Era.
High Speed Love chronicles the romance between two of the finest tip-top tournée racers in history. One of them is the madcap driver, Jacob Irv. His blonde mane graces the cover. Next to Irv's life story, you see a slim biography of an Occidental rock star called the Antistar. He's famous for shooting morphine into one of his eyeballs and cocaine into the other.
I wonder which he sees better out of.
Next to that, Rivershalian radio personality Guillaume Bevy stands in front of a rundown drug den. He's a permanent fixture on Channel 8, reporting on real-life crime and ruining cops' days.
I really must insist you buy one of the books. Reading them is not for free. Do still browse, though, but not too long.
Fuck you. You told me to browse and you wouldn't tell me anything about the books. Now you're just...
I'm sorry. I did not mean to rush you. You are browsing. Go ahead. Take your time. Time is commerce.
No, it's too late. You've offended me now. I'm leaving. But I must get rid of these little dots. A quaint picture book brochure, very colourful. It's a tome of fascist magic. Rather candid. I suppose it's got to have something going for it, isn't it?
These shelves are overburdened with books from the same series. You see the name Dick Mullen over and over.
I've got his hat.
Crime fiction is a disgrace. An asinine misrepresentation of the physical attributes of the arduous everyday work of actual police officers.
And the arduous everyday work. Sorry, I don't mean to pick up on this voice actor's every fumble. He has got a mammoth amount of work to do in this game. Of police work, but at the same time,
over how long it takes to actually follow up on leads and eliminate dead ends. What's more, they completely ignore the psychological hardships of year after year coming into contact with people during the worst days of their lives. Not a single mention of all the stress this work creates upon the officer's family. Detective fiction just doesn't tell the truth at all. Now, would you like a list of all the books found on the shelf?
Sure.
You see, Dick Mullen on the job. Get Me Mullen. The Stalwart Adventures of Richard P. Mullen. Dick Mullen and the Murder in the Orchard. The Sordid Affair of Dick Mullen. A Killing is Declared. Dick Mullen in the Murder House. The Final Case of Dick Mullen. An Obvious Lie. Dick Mullen in the Clock Tower. The Ordeals of Dick Mullen. Dauntless Dick. Dick Mullen's Funeral Pyre. The Murder of Dick Mullen.
Well, that was probably easier for him to say than the other one.
Oh no, turns out he faked it to solve a case. Yes, there's also The Dame Who Did It. Farewell, My Mullen. Faking death seems to be a common trope in the Mullen series. The Morbid Tales of Dick Mullen. A Dark Tide Turns. Tragedy Calls for Dick Mullen. Another one with fake death. And, of course, Dick Mullen, the Murderer. In order to catch a murderer, Dick Mullen must become the murderer. After all this, you still haven't found the answer to the one question that matters. Who is Dick Mullen?
Reaction speed will tell us who Dick Mullen is. Not seeing the connection there, but give it a go.
Your attempt to grasp at the answer fails. It seems very close by, pulsating just out of reach.
We have to get one of these checks right one day, or at least in one in this stream would be nice. Right, let's get out of this fucking place. Let's see what's behind here first.
You see a set of tattered curtains blocking the way to another room. A strange cage-like trinket dangles from the curtains.
Excuse me, officer. The back room is strictly for employees only.
Don't care.
You see some kind of charm, an irregular polyhedron assembled from bones, sticks, and straw. Inside, a disturbing fish head with empty eye sockets stares at you. Aside from poking at it suspiciously, there is nothing else to do with the fish head charm at this time. The curtains remain shut before you.
Nothing. Now please go back to browsing the books. Don't you feel compelled to look at the books? The books are all you care about.
Oddly enough, the more she tries to draw you away from the curtains, the more alluring they become.
Yes, that's because she's a very annoying person. Right, let's open the curtains.
Just as you're about to pull apart the curtains, the petrified voice of the shop owner cries out once more.
Don't touch that. I told you it's off limits for the customers.
No, you want me to do that bit. Okay, her hand has closed around her pendant, her fingers nervously playing with the talisman. Now, I do remember this from prior playthroughs.
Parapsychologically speaking, we're done if you decide to open them. I won't be held responsible for the consequences. It's too dangerous.
Yeah, despite that, I remember this, and I don't give a shit if I'm parapsychologically done with her.
She looks away, mumbling. Why is everyone always messing with the curtains? Why can't they just buy books like normal people?
Because curtains are mysterious, and people probably instinctively dislike you and want to know what you're hiding. This is about the curse, that's why you're afraid. Ma'am, this is different. I'm a police officer. I need to get in there. But I sense this place calling for me. I must investigate beyond the threshold. I don't care, you can't stop me, I'll open them. Alright, I'll think about it for a while. Well, that's kind of the vibe I'm going with, but let's see if we can just convince her, because I don't need her shrill voice doing that in my ear.
Why? It's not like anyone was killed there.
She stops abruptly as her hand flies over her mouth, baffled by her own bluntness.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to be so impolite. Just please don't go there. I can't allow that. You'll only make things worse and unleash the powers.
So it is about the curse?
No, it's just a storeroom for the employees, I told you. Now please step away from the curtains.
Alright, well, I tried to be civil. Fuck you.
No! Please just talk to me, officer. Come here and let's talk this through before you decide to do anything extreme.
Lies. Rip them open, we say. There is something mysterious about the curtains. Be careful. The curtains, tattered with age and covered in dust, hang before you, as if taunting you.
What do you have to say then, just in case there's anything that might sway my mind?
Hello again, esteemed officer, and welcome to...
Yeah, I don't care. Why are you so uptight about the curtains?
I already told you. It's just a storage room for employees. I don't understand why it's so important to you.
It's not important to me. It's clearly important to you, and that's why I'm interested.
Just let it go, officer. Go buy some goddamn books. You're supposed to be drawn to the books.
Only if they're drawing books. If it's just a storage room, then why do you have that strange trinket on the curtains?
It's just for decoration.
She wavers under your gaze, mouth pressed into a tight-lipped smile, then something breaks.
Okay, fine. It's just because this place is cursed, just like everyone said. They don't call it the doomed commercial area for nothing. Are you happy now, officer? Happy that you've ruined everything?
Don't see how I've ruined everything. Why didn't you just tell me right away it's the curse?
It's not good to talk about the curse, not in detail. The negativism, it's dangerous. Talking about the void wraiths angers them.
What the fuck are you talking about?
Such wraiths may prove a formidable enemy. Suit up.
Alright, calm down.
The curse is so much worse than you could imagine. It's a disease, eating at the very foundation.
A shiver runs through the woman as she looks around the dimly lit store.
It's the curse of financial distress, of ruin and bankruptcy.
Didn't that curtain just move?
There is a fan going, so maybe, but it also seems too far away, so maybe not. What does that mean? Annette mentioned that the previous tenants have experienced some financial troubles. Wait, that's it? I was hoping for something more paranormal. Annette did mention this.
It's not just that, officer. We're dealing with something supernatural here. It's
the
catechumens feeding off bad business practices and disappointing income statements.
Cacodemons? They're from Doom, aren't they?
There's something wrong with this building, I can tell you. Ever since I arrived, I've sensed an eerie lingering presence, as if I was unwanted here.
I can't imagine why anyone wouldn't want you here. Have you sought help from anyone? You know, like a therapist?
Yes. I've contacted numerous parapsychologists, and even a pair of Simonese mediators. They provided me with the wards.
The trinket. Okay.
The wards help to keep the doom at bay and protect us against
the darkness that
lies further in the building. Even though now I fear it's not enough.
Well, call me the Doomslayer. Is your pendant part of the wards as well?
No, it's a special Himian amulet, blessed by desert pygmy shamans, with a spell of compulsion. It's to compel people to buy books.
Definitely.
There are numerous spells cast throughout the store. I had the books anointed with a different inducement spell, for example. It's guaranteed to boost sales 15%.
I don't think the curse is real. I just want you to let me in there. Would you like me to take the case? I could investigate, see if the curse is real. I've done this route before. I dislike you.
Most certainly not. I'm not letting you open the gates of hell. In fact, I don't
You're
want
just making
anyone
me want to do it more.
Who isn't familiar with the psychic arts involved in this mess. Stay away. Leave the spirits be, so they can return to their slumber.
Psychic arts? Sounds right down our alley.
Convince her to let you investigate the doomed commercial area. We'd probably get experience for doing this, so we'll give it a go, although we'll probably fail.
Slither up to
oh,
her,
well, fine.
You silver-tongued fiend. Show her what world-class perfidy looks like.
I didn't really want to do this, but... And I don't even know if I've got experience for it, actually. Wait, what if I don't want to lie? Ma'am, I came here to help. I've handled paranormal situations before.
Are you sure? Don't think I haven't seen charlatans before.
Sure, okay, let's talk some psychic bullshit at her. I sense the psychic emanations from afar, the sleeper beyond calls out. I've returned from the void, a paradetective from a long line of paradetectives.
You're no paradetective. You look nothing like one. And you're clearly a drinker. Pardon me for being so blunt, but...
Hey now, hey. You need the booze to focus, all right? The lieutenant keeps his usual stony calm. He silently picks out his notebook. Go ahead then, rock her world, he thinks. I'll compose some notes.
I admit, I've had my share of drinks, but only because the spectral realm is parapsychologically taxing. You see, it's necessary to drink the spirits in order to contact the void. Do you get it? Because spirit. I'll go with the first one.
How do you know all this?
She's probably not one for puns.
Here we go.
I am the void revenant. I have the powers to debad all the bad energies.
I should have realized. A pattern lies within the fabric. The hand of fate guides us.
Yes.
Our meeting couldn't have been mere chance.
No, definitely not.
Perhaps you truly are the one to deliver this woman from the doom.
Don't you start.
But I am not the only one at risk. I have to think of my daughter. You are certain you can help us? Keep us safe? I can't allow any collateral damage to hit us.
Why do you have to think of your daughter? You haven't before now. No problem whatsoever. Your family is safe. The phantoms are no match for me. Just ask my partner, Kim. He'll vouch for me. The lieutenant mumbles in minor confusion. He has not been listening closely enough. You've put him on the spot.
I can assure you he is a police officer. Very knowledgeable.
Thank you.
If you promise, good officer, then you might be our last hope. Do you swear it?
Hand on your heart. On my honour. Actually, I'm not really feeling the vibe anymore. The psychic force has left me. Fine, whatever.
Thank you, sir. There's one more thing I haven't told you about yet.
Oh, yeah.
The entity.
Do not act surprised. You know of these things, sire.
Of course, the entity. For I have sensed its presence.
You have? The entity takes the form of a woman. A witch, probably. I've suspected that she must be connected to the curse ever since I first saw her. Did you know that she lives inside the chimney?
Chimneys aren't big enough for that. Chimney, the passage between heaven and hell, of course.
Yes, that chimney is part of the building's central furnace, and it's
fucking
enormous.
Easy, isn't it? You just make
she
up any old shit.
She has barricaded herself behind some metal security curtains. God knows what she's doing there. Some unnatural magic, I assume. You should go find the entity and ask what happened to all the companies in the building. What is the source of this curse? Here's the key to the warded door behind the curtains. Take it. Oh, and please do return to me after you've looked round. I'm quite anxious to know what she has to say about the curse. What you discover in there.
Unbelievable darkness and ruin.
Okay, cool, bye. So I guess the upside to that is you get the key. to the door.
You see a set of...
Well, the curtain's open.
You see a dimly lit room full of dusty furniture and trash. A doorway stands in the back, covered in dozens of scary little cage-like trinkets, your shadow looming over it like an omen.
Why are you terrified? We had a very lengthy explanation and conversation about how I was going to do this. Fuck's sake. Some doodads and whatnots. Ghostly silhouettes of hairdryers. No sane person would ever put their head into such machine. Into. Could conjoin those two words to the word into, really, but whatever. A vaguely androgynous portrait of a man. Merely looking at that unmanly haircut threatens your masculinity. Alright, fine.
A heavy door with a missing handle stands before you, covered in dozens, if not hundreds, of little oddly shaped trinkets and charms. It appears to be locked.
Well, 9. I'm not going to say that's hundreds. Maybe the others are smaller and you can't see them. Knock on the door, unlock the door with the key. Yeah, see, that's your only other option, is to try and break it down. Which, to be fair, we have quite high physique. So we might have been able to do that. Although at the same time it's saying 42%, so I don't... And given how the rest of this has gone, I don't trust our chances.
After
so we'll use the key.
Some force, you manage to turn the key. It's eerily silent. The door slides slightly open, letting a draft of cold air into the room. You feel the tiny hairs on the back of your neck rise up, as if someone's standing right behind you.
Someone is standing right behind me. Kim's standing... Well, I guess he's standing to the side.
An uneasy knot forms in the pit of your stomach.
That's nothing new. Kim, maybe you should go first.
Detective, you're the one in charge.
Fuck you, Kim. You've stabbed me in the back. I was going to hum the X-Files tune, but I'll probably get DMCA'd.
Hello. What is this place?
The lieutenant stares at the dusty training equipment. It's the netherworld beyond the veil.
No, it's a gym. Though it looks like no one's been here in ages.
That's what I said. The netherworld.
I doubt the electricity still works. We should find a flashlight if we want to go on. There should be one in my kinema.
Kinema? I always thought kinema.
An eerie feeling rises in your chest.
What if there's a reason why no one's been here for ages?
Yes, because it's closed.
Oh.
No need to look for supernatural explanations where a banal one will do. Now, let's go get the flashlight, shall we?
I guess we could. Sand is dripping from a punch bag. The poster says Sitius Fortis, the rest is worn off. Worn out wall bars, they look unsafe.
A barbell lies on the floor. The color has worn off its weight plates. It's 60 kilograms. Your triceps hum at the sight of these weights. Show the world what kind of beast it's dealing with. Lift them.
Sure, I can totally do that.
There are no collars on the barbell. This is a safety hazard.
Shut up, safety hazard.
Why does it feel so familiar?
Is this familiar because I'm a weightlifter? Look, Kim, it's a trap. There are no collars on the barbell. Legendary. Oh, have to lift. 28%. Is this familiar because I'm a weightlifter?
No, it's not that. It's the stale smell of rubber. The squeaky sound of sneakers. Your bruised knee against the mat. And a whistle. Then the feeling is gone. It's just a memory.
Memories are important when you have none.
A memory from another life. when you were young and fit.
I'm still young and fit. Watch this. Oh, shit. Probably should have taken off the gardening gloves. Fuck! Well, at least I've been dropping on my head.
The ground, but the barbell feels wobbly and dangerous. Your hands slick with sweat. Turns out you're no beast. Just an old man with bad form. See? See? This place is cursed.
Seems like I'm a little out of shape, or maybe these gloves just suck. Yeah, I did think that. Whatever, weightlifting is for the intellectually impaired anyway. Fuck you, you stupid barbell. No, it's the gloves.
Proper weightlifting gloves would definitely afford a better grip.
Yeah. And also it is a trap.
You're right. The weight may fall off. Better not touch it then.
I mean, I already did, but okay. What kind of a bastard would just remove the collars? It should be a felony.
It would be a violation of EPIS safety regulations if the gym was still operating. But it isn't. No one's supposed to come here anymore.
Hmm. We'll see about that. Oh. Okay, I was looking at...
Yes?
I was looking at the thing by the... I'll talk to you later. Shot put. Don't know why that kept happening. Item gained, shot put. Sick. £4.50. Or real, or whatever. Cool, cool. So, do we actually need a flashlight, or can we just, you know, bullshit our way through? The hallway is blocked by old window panes and debris. Yeah, we actually need the flashlight. Well, okay then. Are you just going to tell me as much?
It's dark.
He does state the obvious.
This would be a lot easier with a flashlight. I've got one in the kinema's toolbox. We should go back for it before we continue. No sense in tripping around in the darkness.
Fine. Got rid of the curse, you're welcome. Laters. Spirited chirps and clicks of swallows fill the air. Tire tracks leading onto the roof. The slush and rain has almost washed them off. An ancient fountain. It doesn't pump water anymore. There's a tree in it. Alright. Ooh, purple. A sewer grate, a gateway to the River of Filth. I'd like to go to the River of Filth. No, can't. What's this? Dumpster diving? Ooh, fingerless gloves. Which boost my electrochemistry, apparently. Might be better than the gardening ones. At this point, it's hard to tell, really. Water lock out of order until Wednesday, 7:15 a.m. Butter sign down. What? What's going on here?
Good day to you, officers.
Oh, you're Australian.
A burly man hangs out by the water lock, carving up a generous serving of salami with an old hunter's knife. His eyes are fixed on a man stranded on the other side of the water lock and on an enormous billboard that has fallen down into the canal between them. His posture is relaxed. Despite his powerful build and a knife in his hand, this man resorts to physical intimidation only infrequently, if at all.
All right, thanks, Pyramid Head. First things first, what are you doing here, man on the water lock?
My friend Barry the Butcher is stuck on the other side of the water lock. I'm keeping him company and eating his salami.
Crikey, fuck.
From the corner of your eye, you see a man in a yellow shirt and grey overalls waving at you from across the canal.
He's not waving.
He seems disappointed about the wreckage on the water lock and the salami.
Very good stuff. Anything I can do for you, officer?
The man on the water lock picks the skin off a slice of salami and takes a sizable bite. Do you know what caused this wreckage?
I wasn't here to witness it, but those look like tire tracks on that sign. Weird, huh? Then again, plenty of daredevil drivers in Rivershoal.
The words daredevil driver sound ominous to you.
I was a race car driver.
Too bad it also takes a year and a day to repair anything around here. Especially a water lock. The rest of the coast is closed off till then.
Fuck. Do you know what's further down the coast?
Well, there's the fishing village, an abandoned fish market, a bizarro church. Not much use to the congregation, though. There always seems to be something wrong with it. Yeah, not really much else. Just bombed out ruins.
Cool. Can I have some salami?
Sure thing. Want some too, officer?
Why not?
Nice. Got some salami. Is that like actual salami that I got, or is that just a thing? That was just a thing. I hope for a second there it might give me my health back, but no, no such luck. I do have one charge. That would be the nosefed stuff I got. Was it? Maybe? Don't know. Anyway, probably risky to be walking around at one health. I'd say the same for morale, but we've got nothing to up it at the moment. Roy's Pawn Shop. Fast cash for faster times. Pawn shop sounds good. We can probably, we could sell the shop and then, actually have some money for a change. Crikey. A lot going on here. Some kind of machine. An antique cash register? Probably. Cash register would probably be there otherwise, wouldn't it? In the dark, a film projector is whirring away. A bust of a woman. The plaque simply says Day? D-E-I. Deirdre Emmanuel Inc.
You see rows of toy soldiers guarding the rest of the trinkets displayed on the table. Some on horseback, others in rags, others yet in bright blue uniforms. All are stern and unyielding in their duty. Try to find something pretty and cool here, then use it to win her back.
Win her back?
Yes. Buy something nice. A figurine.
Okay, thanks for the elaboration there. Interface. Shit, well, hang on, can I... Fuck, you can't once you're in this. Although I can go back to it, can't I? Hang on. If I change my gloves again, then I'll have better interfacing skill in order to find a better action figure.
You see rows of toy soldiers guarding the rest of the trinkets displayed on the table.
Let's inspect these first, I suppose.
Others in rack. Big men on big horses, clad in lamella armor and carrying flintlocks. The kind that would mow down a line of enemy soldiers in the blink of an eye.
Who are they?
Franco-Nigerian knights. I used to be very serious about these guys.
A long, long time ago.
Oh.
They're not all blue. These figurines also wear gold coats and caps, complemented by orange trousers. They are variously posed, wielding swords and rifles with bayonets.
What are these?
Which ones? Ah, royalist soldiers from the time of the revolution. The uniforms are painted a bit too brightly, I suppose.
Bird's Nest Rory. Okay, hello. Inspect the figurines in rags.
This set of soldiers isn't meant to look impressive. A few have rifles, but most of them carry pistols. Some even shovels and tall sticks.
Are these even soldiers?
You're probably talking about the revolutionaries, yes? Yes, they are soldiers, revolutionary soldiers. I think their poverty has been exaggerated for effect. When you place them next to the royalists, it doesn't seem like they could possibly win.
It's meant to give people hope, even we can do it. The contrast is meant to be disheartening, as it ought to be. I wish it was more nuanced. As it stands, I cannot comment. I mean, yeah, I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about.
I don't like either set very much, to be honest. But there are many parents among my customers.
Really? You have parents coming in here? That seems weird. Okay. Right, let's find a cool thing.
Why? What's this? A headless man riding a horse? A headless man wearing futuristic tracksuit trousers that say foul?
What's this?
Oh, that's the headless fawn rider.
Who?
The headless fawn rider. It's an urban legend. About a man who rides the streets of Revachol sporting a fawn tracksuit. As you see, he's missing his head. 50 cents. Bargain price. I'll throw in the tiny cap too. I think he's looking for it, or something. That part of the story has many interpretations.
Do we want to buy this? What possible use is this going to have? And this would take all of our very little money. But then I did just do a check for it. This is adventure game logic. Something weird like this is going to be useful later down the road. Line. Game. Maybe. I can't actually remember from last time when I played this.
Did I mention that this figurine is supposed to be lucky? Always carry it with you.
Alright. I wonder if that's an actual thing. It actually makes you more lucky. The plastic headless fawn rider sits atop his equally plastic bull, his posture indicating either desperation or pride. Comes as a set with the infamous fawn cap for which he lost his head. The head is not included. Is it a thing I can put somewhere? No, I just have to put it there and hope it is actually lucky. I'm not sure it is. Mostly military wear with a few more eccentric fashions thrown in.
The boomboxes on the shelf look well loved and well travelled. Chipped, dented, they stare at you with the unblinking eyes of their tape reels. One especially catches your eye. Deep gold and amber plastic with a big old handle on top. A classic boombox that says, Stereo 8 approved. This is you. Gold and orange. A sunset suite.
Okay.
Just make sure it works before you buy it.
I can't afford it. Unless it is actually 10 cents. A Could this device come in handy in my police work? Are you sure this is all in working order? Shopkeep, this Stereo 8 approved machine here. Does it work?
Absolutely. I've tested each one myself with recordings of speech, found sounds and music from a variety of genres. Even though I don't really like music.
You're weird.
Is the Harman Welshi W2, made in Vespa, designed in Seoul, plays all reel-to-reel formats, 2mm, 8mm, 12mm. It's even got a little radio in there. It'll set you back 12 real.
Shit, 12's a... maybe not a lot, but it's a lot compared to what I've got. Could it be handy in my police work?
If police work means playing tapes, sure. You can use it for that. Or any other time you'd need to play a tape.
I was playing a tape in my room when I got shit-faced and went crazy. Maybe I could piece that back together or use it for something. We'll come back to that. Try and maybe get something.
A typical Martinez streetlight sits among assorted floor and table lamps.
Is that a streetlight?
Yes, officer. As you see, it's in perfect working order.
That's twice he's changed as you can see into as you see. Sorry, I can't help but notice these things.
His manner is casual, but his speech is careful, measured. He wants you to know that he has nothing to hide.
Where did you get this?
It was brought to me to be altered.
We are not here to investigate the theft of city property.
Aren't we, though?
You have to admit it's rather clever what he's done with it.
How is it clever?
The light pole has been carefully cut, and the wiring has been redone and attached to a standard indoor plug. The light buzzes faintly, but persistently.
How much for the street light?
700 real. A bargain, I dare say.
A bargain? No, it's not. He's trying to sweet talk you into buying trash.
Are you out of your mind? There's one light just like that on every corner. Even taking into account the risk of obtaining the light, that seems a bit steep. 700 sounds about right. I imagine it wasn't easy sawing off that street lamp. I don't think I will ever obtain 700 real in this game. Nor have I ever. Nor is it even probably possible. So you're out of your fucking mind.
The light has undergone 3 transformations, and every transformation, large or small, has a price tag.
What do you mean, transformation?
Well, there are the costs of removal and rewiring. The most important transformation is the light's placement among ordinary indoor fixtures, which has adjusted its morphological field. The light became suitable for use inside the home just a few days ago.
I wonder. I'm not, that feels like just one of them things that you just can't ever get. Or unless there's some part of this game, some super hidden thing where you can just find a fucking shit ton of money. Alright. Well, cheers for the little action figure, I guess. Nothing much else here, although we'll come back for the boombox at some point. That much is true. Streetlight is probably a bit of a lost cause. Oh, hello, what's that? It's Nosefed, which is health. Super. Well, I was going to go to the shop, but no money. That's a shame. Yep, dead body's still there. Thank you. Well, we should get that torch at least. He said it was in his cart.
Before you stands a motor carriage. The bodywork is covered in blue and white livery, bearing the number 57. This must be the infernal machine that tore you from oblivion.
You mean the thing that woke me up?
In the cabin, you are welcomed by a set of steering levers, a radio microphone on a hook, a pull-out toolbox under the seat, and the soft glow of the fuel preheater gauge.
Hmm. Yeah, so this is all sort of steampunk kind of tech level, I guess. I mean, the car seems very kind of that. The toolbox.
A metallic drawer slides out from under the seat and clicks into place. The tools inside are neatly organized.
Take what you need, officer. It's going to be a long case. I'm not protective of my tools, like some men are.
Hmm.
He's clearly a little protective of his tools. But what can you do? Work is work.
I'll promise not to piss on them. Take the red-tipped pry bar, which I believe is just their word for a crowbar.
The pry bar feels nice and cold in your hand. Heavier than you'd think. Cold and heavy, like truth. You feel like you're reunited with truth once more.
This is just my inner psychopath talking, I think.
Useful for opening all sorts of doors and lids.
Oh, okay, no, apparently. Whatever. Take the chain cutters, sure.
The handles are long and sleek. Snap, snap, go the cutters in your hand. You can do good work with these. Cut chains, locks, and ropes, especially belts.
Oh, belts? Wait. Really? I don't remember that being a thing, but we're going to check, because obviously, if we can avoid having to ask the dock workers about the corpse, that's handy. And the flashlight.
It's robust, weatherproof, and well-made. Police issue. Blue. Lets you see things in the dark you would otherwise miss.
Yeah, they're good like that.
The pull-out toolbox slides back into its nest. Preheater gauge casts a warm glow on the steering levers and the radio on its hook. As you tap on the gauge, the indicator pin jerks as if startled. It's in the large orange sector, indicating the engine is warm. Next to the gauge is a red switch labeled heat.
So, literally powered by steam, possibly.
There's no use pressing the heat button. It won't start without the ignition key.
Translation. We're not going anywhere right now.
Aww.
Alternative translation. Don't even think you can drive my MC.
I wasn't thinking that. I was just tapping shit.
The white suede feels luxurious under the touch. And the metal clutch handle so very familiar in your palm.
Why is it familiar? What?
This is the Cupri Skinema, my motor carriage. You can use the toolbox and the radio if you'd like.
Motor carriage. Something bad with a motor carriage. A dark lump rises in your throat.
What is this sinking feeling I have with the words motor carriage?
Nothing. It's probably nothing. Forget I brought it up. Please proceed with the carefree lollygagging.
You're very suspicious, Inland Empire, but yes, I will continue with my somewhat carefree lollygagging. Can we turn it on and drive somewhere? I want to go to McDonald's.
No, I'm afraid not. We have a murder case on our hands, remember?
Aww. I'm hungry. I want to go to the swimming pool. I want a new jumper. That's not a thing kids say. I don't know why that doesn't work, does it? No. Yeah, moving on.
The Cupris Motor Corps does provide most of our patrol vehicles, yes.
But this is different. This is a sports model.
I might be wrong, but this is different. This is a sports model. Maybe, right?
You're right. I didn't take you for a motor car enthusiast. Do you also like tip-top, detective?
I don't know what you're saying. What is tip-top?
An inter-insular racing series. You should definitely give it a go if you like motor carriages. It has fantastic competition.
So like Top Gear, but tip-top gear or something. This must be what woke me up when you arrived in Martinet, the infernal noise.
Yes, sorry about that. The Cupris Kinema does have a rather distinctive engine sound.
He says it with very badly concealed pride. In the cabin, you see a set of steering levers, a radio on a hook, a
pull-out toolbox,
and the soft glow of the fuel preheater gauge.
Alright, let's pick up the radio.
Lights up, and a green button labeled Prime Line glows like a feline eye. And then you hear something. The soft purr of electrical kittens, radio waves cast far and wide over the metropolis. A woman's voice greets you through the static.
This is Precinct 57. Hello, Lieutenant. How may I assist you?
She has a voice.
Hello, Alice. Please assist our colleague from the 41st Precinct here. I'm putting him on.
Operating the radio is easy. Just be confident. You've probably done it 1,000 times.
Come in, dispatch. Come in, dispatch. Come in, Delta 10. This is Firewalker. Copy. Hi, Alice. This is the officer from the 41st Precinct speaking. Nice to meet you.
This is Officer Alice Demetri, Precinct 57. How may I assist you?
You could swear she was friendlier with the lieutenant.
Under the green Prime Line, a yellow saved button catches your eye. I wonder what Kim's default radio station is.
Kim? It says the lieutenant. It's fine. I do wonder what Kim's default saved radio station is. Let's press it.
As always, it's DJ Mesh and Fellatio, and you're listening to Street Freaks FM, bringing you the hottest, the nastiest, the most vulgar.
Right away, the lieutenant reaches into the cabin and turns off the radio. He's not looking at you, as he says.
Someone must have been messing with the radio, or maybe picked up a random frequency. You wanted a prime line, right?
How embarrassing. Also, that was an interesting way of pronouncing that word. I would have gone with Flaccio or Flacio, not Fellatio. But fine. That's whatever. Everyone's got to have a DJ name, I suppose. Speed Freaks FM, huh?
Oh. Is that what it was called?
Right, you don't want to get into this, no problem.
Nothing to get into, really. But sure, let's focus on the important things.
This is Precinct 57. Can I connect it to someone?
Think of it this way, Kim. At least it wasn't hardcore porn. Although I'm pretty sure they don't play hardcore porn on the radio. But this is fiction. Anything could happen. Anyway, we'll leave it there for now and continue with our hijinks next time. Our hijinks, our low jinks, all kinds of jinks. Cheers for watching. And don't let people fiddle with your radio stations. Who even has that anymore? Like, it's all old world, isn't it, having radios? Bygone era. Anyway, bye.